Have you ever wondered why you can sleep for 8 hours but still wake up feeling exhausted? Or why a 6-hour sleep sometimes feels more refreshing than a longer one? The answer lies in your sleep cycles. I'm Dr. Tracey Marks, a psychiatrist, and today we're talking about how your brain moves through different stages of sleep and why understanding these cycles is important for your mental resilience. Most people think of sleep as just switching off for a few hours, but your brain actually steps through different stages throughout the night. Each stage serves a specific purpose in healing and re-energizing your brain. By understanding these cycles, you can optimize your sleep to support your brain's natural restoration process. Let's start by looking at the architecture of sleep. Your sleep isn't one continuous state. It's made up of multiple 90-minute cycles, and each cycle contains 4 distinct stages. Think of it like a washing machine with different cycles. You need all of them to really clean your clothes. Similarly, you need all of the stages of sleep to get a complete mental and physical restoration. During each 90-minute cycle, your brain progresses through 2 types of sleep: non-REM sleep, which includes stages 1, 2, and 3, and REM sleep, and REM stands for rapid eye movement. Let's break down what happens in each stage. Stage 1 is that drowsy state where you're just starting to drift off. Your brain waves start to slow down, and you might experience muscle jerks that may even wake you back up. This stage typically only lasts a few minutes. More things happen, though, in stage 2. In this stage, your brain produces brief bursts of activity called sleep spindles. Sleep spindles are important for memory consolidation and learning. They help transfer information from short-term to long-term memory. Also in this stage, your body temperature drops and your heart rate slows down. You'll spend about 50% of your total sleep time in this stage. Stage 3 is deep sleep, and this is where the real healing happens. Your brain waves slow down dramatically into what we call delta waves. During this stage, your body releases growth hormone that repairs tissue, strengthens your immune system, and helps maintain your brain's infrastructure. It's like having a maintenance crew come in and repair and restore your brain. This is also when your brain's waste removal system kicks into high gear. It's called the glymphatic system. Just like your body has the lymphatic system to remove metabolic waste, your brain has the glymphatic system. During deep sleep, this system becomes 10 times more active, flushing out toxins and metabolic waste products that accumulate while you're awake. The spaces between the brain cells actually expand during this time, allowing for more efficient cleaning, similar to how a city street cleaner works better when there's less traffic on the road. So those are the non-REM stages of sleep. Let's now talk about REM sleep, which is where most dreaming occurs. During REM sleep, your brain is highly active, processing emotions from the day and integrating them into your memories. This processing helps to soften the intense emotional experiences, which makes it easier to handle difficult memories or stressful events without getting overwhelmed by them. REM sleep is also linked to creativity and problem solving. When you're in REM, your brain can make new connections and approach problems with different perspectives. And this is one reason why you might wake up with a fresh solution for a problem or feel less affected by something that was bothering you the day before. So what can disrupt these cycles? One major disruptor is alcohol. While it might help you fall asleep initially, alcohol severely disrupts your REM sleep, robbing you of the important emotional processing time. Caffeine can also interfere by making it harder to enter into deep sleep, even if you consumed it several hours before bedtime. I've heard many people say, "Oh, I can drink coffee in the evening and it doesn't keep me from falling asleep." Well, you might fall asleep just fine, but falling asleep is only one phase of sleep. What you don't know is what that caffeine is doing to the rest of your sleep stages, like REM sleep. Screen time close to bedtime also disrupts your sleep cycles in multiple ways. Research published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences found that using electronic devices before bed not only delays your natural sleep timing, but also reduces REM sleep and affects how alert you feel the next day. The mental stimulation from processing information keeps your brain in an activated state, making it harder to transition through the sleep stages naturally. So this is more than about blue light. This disruption is from too much brain stimulation before bed. How can you optimize your sleep cycles? Here's where the timing becomes important. Remember that 90-minute cycle that I mentioned? You can use this to your advantage. Try planning your bedtime around complete 90-minute cycles. For example, if you need to wake up at 6 a.m., count backwards in 90-minute increments to find your ideal bedtime. This might be 10:30 p.m. for 5 cycles, or 9 p.m. for 6 cycles. You can also try using a smart alarm app that monitors your movement to wake you up during the lightest sleep phase. Strategic napping can also support your sleep cycles, but timing is everything. A 20-minute power nap during the day can be refreshing without disrupting your nighttime sleep. The 20 minutes also keeps you in a lighter stage of sleep. Or you can aim for a full 90-minute nap, which is a complete cycle. You want to avoid waking up during deep sleep, which can leave you feeling very groggy. Your body temperature plays a huge role in sleep cycles too. Your core temperature needs to drop to initiate and maintain good sleep. Try timing your exercise or hot shower about 2 hours before bed. As your body cools down from these activities, it can help trigger the natural temperature drop that promotes sleep. Another thing you can do to improve your deep sleep is to leverage the power of your hearing. Even though consciousness is turned off while we're asleep, our brains are still listening. You can enhance your slow wave sleep with pink noise. You've probably heard of white noise, but pink noise is a little different. White noise contains all the frequencies with equal power, but pink noise emphasizes the lower frequencies, creating a deeper, more balanced sound, like rainfall or ocean waves. A 2017 study published in Frontiers in Human Neuroscience found that people listening to pink noise showed a 13% increase in deep sleep time and performed better on memory tests the next day. Using pink noise is like having a sound engineer fine-tune your brain waves to the optimal frequency for deep sleep. And you don't need expensive equipment to try this. There are many apps and online sources that provide pink noise. The key is to keep the volume low, around the sound level of a quiet air conditioner, just loud enough to be noticeable but not distracting. Meal timing affects your sleep cycles as well. Late dinners or bedtime snacks can prevent your brain from entering deep sleep effectively. Try to eat your last meal at least 3 hours before bedtime to give your digestive system time to settle. And one often overlooked factor is natural light exposure. Getting bright light exposure in the morning helps strengthen your circadian rhythm, which in turn can help regulate your sleep cycles. Try to get at least 10 to 15 minutes of natural light within an hour of waking up. You also want to consider your chronotype, that is, your natural tendency to feel alert or sleepy at certain times. And it's more than about labeling yourself a morning lark or a night owl. It's about your body's natural biological rhythm. About 40% of people are morning types, and 30% are evening types, and the rest fall somewhere in between. Morning types naturally feel sleepy around 9 to 10 p.m. and wake up easily around 5 or 6 a.m. Evening types, on the other hand, naturally get sleepy after midnight and would sleep until 8 or 9 a.m. if given the chance. If you're forcing yourself to follow a schedule that fights against your natural chronotype, you're essentially living in a constant state of social jet lag. You can't completely change your chronotype because it's partly determined by genetics, but you can work with it. If you're a night owl who has to wake up early, you might need to be more strict about your wind-down routine and light exposure. Using bright light in the morning and dimming lights earlier in the evening can help shift your rhythm slightly earlier. But don't expect to suddenly become a morning person. The goal is to find a sustainable rhythm that works with your life demands while respecting your natural tendencies. And finally, I know I've said a lot here, sleep tracking apps and devices can provide insights into your sleep cycles, but don't become obsessed with the data. Use them as a general guide rather than a strict measure of your sleep quality. Good sleep is more about quality and timing than quantity. By understanding and working with your natural sleep cycles, you're giving your brain the best chance to heal, process emotions, and maintain optimal function. If you found this video helpful, subscribe and hit the bell for notifications. Next week, we'll explore what's happening in your brain during those frustrating nights when sleep just won't come and what you can do about it. Thanks for watching today. See you next time.